As a last point, I'd like to approach a thorny issue that has many different angles and facets to it, and that's with respect to plagiarism, in the sense that you talk about in this day, this electronic age, information is so available and it's so easy to access information, and it's a double-edged sword in the sense that it's so easy that it's easy to take and copy information, but it's also, because everything is electronic, it's so easy to compare a paper to what has already been published using different software tools that the editors have available. And so the concept of plagiarism is magnifying simply because now it's so detectable.
Yeah.
And I'm just wondering if you have any thoughts that you'd like to bring forward about what is really taboo, what are things that should not be done, because there are things that these software programs can pick up. They can pick up reference citations as plagiarism just because that reference has been cited in so many papers. It technically flags a plagiarism, but it is not.
Right.
And so what are the types of plagiarism that are the no-nos in a paper that are, by the editor's eyes, simply unacceptable?
Yeah, the direct plagiarism, of course, and even before the access to these tools that you're talking about that we all use these days to help us, it's amazing how many referees catch things, because the human mind is neat in it. You read something and you say, I heard this before somewhere, or almost this before. And it's amazing how many referees have caught things that have been plagiarized or self-plagiarized, where an author is trying to get too many papers that are saying the same thing out of the same set of data, extending the data a bit, salami science, whatever you want to call it, where they're
dicing and slicing the data into many papers.
Yeah, it's saying the same thing. And yes, there are only so many ways to say something. And so in materials and methods, if there's any place where you're going to see some things that start looking very familiar, it's pretty hard to say something about the sampling, et cetera, that's still short and concise, that doesn't sound an awful lot like somebody else's work. But editors are looking for plagiarism. They don't want to see work that obviously has been taken from somebody else's at all. Mm-hmm. That is an absolute no-no. Mm-hmm.
To me, it's just so easy to cite somebody. If you want something to be in your paper that makes sense to your paper, and you really want that thought to be there.
Yeah.
That thought, if taken from someone else's paper, that
cited.
Other paper simply should be cited.
Exactly.
That allows you to use that information, but it is appropriately cited and attribution is appropriately given to the person who had those thoughts.
That's right.
You still have those thoughts in your paper. It still adds to your paper and the overall scholarly nature of your paper. And so there is no real need to have any form of plagiarism where you are misrepresenting your thought processes, because it is almost as useful and as important that you have thought to include someone else's thought processes, but given them attribution to it. And then you go on and expand those thought processes in the way you want to. And that's what the paper is all about.
Yeah, completely agree. And I can't emphasize enough the importance of good, clear citations. When appropriate, and we can probably, yes, some people can put in too many, but the editor can take care of that if they mm-hmm. feel that it's you've cited the same thing six times, and we know that you're using this reference and you're citing it, and the idea came starting here in your reasoning, and you don't have to say again, Smith, 1967, Smith, you know.
Mm-hmm. And it's also interesting that you say as well, we talk about electronification of everything. If plagiarism is a form of flattery in some cultures, in the sense that they want to use a mentor's words because it is simply, they believe, the best concise description of that,
the best honor is
the citation.
Exactly.
Because in this world of electronification, all these citations are now being hyperlinked at the end of the paper and are keyword searchable. They actually link to the original work of paper if that paper is also electronic, and so the greatest form of flattery is in fact the actual citation and the referencing of that person's work.
That's right.
And anything else other than that is a misrepresentation of your own scholarly activity.
That's right. And sometimes one wants to cite something, a short phrase, a short declaration that is really meaningful and that came from somebody, then put it in quotes too. It's the exact words. Mm-hmm. The exact words that person
used. As opposed to be paraphrased.
Instead of being paraphrased. Now, usually, of course, we're paraphrasing. And I find that some scientists have gotten into difficulty because when they read some papers that are in their area, they've made notes. And sometimes they've made notes that were direct quotes without putting them in direct quotes. And then later when they're writing something, it ends up being the exact words that the person used. Well, it usually doesn't happen, but it can, and one should be extremely careful of that and use citations, but also look for and make sure that if you're going to use direct quotes, exact phrasing, exact sentences, then make sure you quote them directly.
And in many cultures where English is a second language and the author is challenging right. English, it is a natural tendency to take stuff that has been written on the in other papers verbatim, simply because the personal effort required to translate their own right. thoughts in that way is prohibitive.
That's right.
So in these regards, that is one of the reasons why we see a lot more plagiarism out of Asia and other non-English language
exactly.
speaking countries. And I fully understand how that, although it's labeled as plagiarism, it is not necessarily perceived as plagiarism. It is just an English second language necessity
right.
to get the material out and down on paper.
Yes.
So are there any thoughts as to how an author can linguistically get around that as they're constructing their own paper?
Again, working with someone else whose first language is English can really help them. So that they can talk about it and say, this is what I'm trying to say. And I just saw a paper, sometime in the last year, one of our journals brought it to my attention. And again, it was a young author from Asia, and I could see exactly what he had done. He didn't intend to plagiarize. He was trying to tell what these people did, what he did. And, of course, the best wording that he could come up with was not in He could do it in whatever his home language was, but he couldn't do it in English so clearly, so he had copied some things down. And the editor was trying to, or the referee was trying to point out, well, this sentence is exactly word for word, then there's another sentence that isn't, and then there's one that isn't. I said, well, you see what he's doing? He couldn't write in English well, and so he fell into the trap of, well, this English-speaking writer writes it so well, I can't say it any better at all, but you can. And that's where you just got to talk to somebody, talk to a writing assistant, talk to an editor that can help you, an author's editor, help you rephrase it, mm-hmm. help you say what you're trying to say without...
And quite honestly, from the editorial side of things like what we do here at Editage, if the author is actually upfront with our editorial service, that I tried my best, but I know these things need
exactly.
to be reworked and reworded.
Exactly.
That is the role of the editorial service. It is the role of the author's editor to help the author clean those aspects of the manuscript in order to support the author, to give them the best chance of getting into peer review
that's
and
right.
having the papers accepted. So if the author actually acknowledges up front to whoever they're working with that I really need English language help in these regards because this stuff has been... has the potential to be labeled as plagiarized because I needed to use them because I couldn't write it otherwise.
That's right.
Please help me in modifying these areas of the paper so that they are in my own words.
Exactly. I couldn't have said it better myself. That's where often the help is most needed. You get the two extremes of a writer whose first language is not English. They either really work hard to write it on their own and not copy phrases and things that they've done, and therefore they have trouble with the editor or reader understanding it directly, or they copy it directly and then it's plagiarism, no matter how you look at it. So we have to just admit when we're in those areas that we can't do it all ourselves. We need some help. This is what we're trying to say. This is where we took some things from for ideas. this is what we're trying to bring across to a reader. How can you help me say that without?
Okay. And it's been a pleasure talking with you today. I'd just like to ask one more question regarding plagiarism. From the journal's perspective, what are the ramifications for the author if, in fact, a journal identifies that this paper has a significant amount of plagiarism in it? Other than the outright rejection and return of the paper, what is the long-term ramification potentially of that author trying to resubmit to that journal again? What type of stigma resides in the journal, and how is that stigma actually transferable from journal to journal and within the editorial community?
Yeah, several possible ramifications depending on the particular journal, depending on the severity. In most cases these days, the journal would notify a senior officer at the institution where the author was from about the issue, why we thought it was so significant and so severe, so that they could pursue other measures if they felt like it. They likely would be blacklisted from the journal sometimes for a while, though sometimes the author would tell them, we don't want to see your submissions for the next some period of time. Others will simply say, we don't want to see anything from you again. So that's very severe. And while editors don't try to, they don't advertise these kinds of things, they can't help but talk with each other, and somebody calls up, another editor calls up and say, I've got a manuscript from so-and-so. There's something funny about it. And this editor says, well, yes, we had a manuscript from them, and we rejected it, and it was plagiarized, etc. So word gets around no matter how confidential we try to keep things. And authors should be aware that it's just they're just hurting themselves.
Mm-hmm. So the obvious answer is to take the high road is always the best course.
That's right.
And to protect yourself, protect your career by taking the time, using editorial services, using colleagues to help you with English language services.
Yeah. Disclosure to the editor.
Disclosure to the editor about all aspects of the paper.
That's right.
To be clean about what you are doing and why you are doing it.
Exactly.
And how you did it. Is the high road is always the best, because the ramifications, especially in these days of electronification, these mistakes do not go away.
That's right. They certainly don't.
In closure, is there any other types of things that you'd like to bring up that you might like to have as a message to your readership?
Editors are always looking for some neat, good science, some good stories, some interesting results, some interesting new things. So we're looking for good work. We're looking for things that are clear, concise, well written, to the point. We want to get your information as a scientist to readers.
Okay, that's great. Thank you very much, Bruce. This Don Samulack from Editage, Division of Cactus Communication, has been talking with Bruce Dancik, the Editor-in-Chief of NRC Research Press in Canada, and we're at the 54th annual meeting of the Council of Science Editors in Baltimore, Maryland, in, I guess it's May of 2011.
That's right.
Thank you.
My pleasure, Dan.